Okay, lovely people. We're going to talk about descriptivism and prescriptivism. So the most important thing to keep in mind is, of course, just the verbs to describe and to prescribe. So similar sounding words, very different meanings. So keep in mind, of course, this is what we call a false dichotomy, in that both sides, no one is ever fully one or the other, but we can give some interesting examples that should kind of help to color your definition and your understanding of each. So prescriptivism is probably the easiest. We're going to think of three different groups. The French immortals. We're going to think about the long S society, and we're going to think about the Unicode group 5.0, I think the current version is. So the immortals, basically in France, their job is to keep track, to make sure that French is pure and immortal and that it lives on and maintains this sort of clarity, coherence, everything. And so they're, you know, a group of mostly elderly people, and they're very serious. They get dressed up, they have their own swords, they meet in very important looking rooms, and they're given great social status and cachet within their society. So their job is just basically to make sure, to make decisions on the language. So they're going to say things like, just so that you know, this new word that has been brought about, we believe it has this gender, and they're going to say, this is a new word, we're adding this into the language, or we've noticed this has been happening and this should stop, and instead we should use this. So they're prescribing the way that French, the pure language as they see it, should be kept together. A smaller one, there's a group called the Long S Society. We know from our study of the kind of development of English across time that there was initially a long S that looked kind of like an F, without the slash through it, or sometimes just the back half of the slash and not the front half. And then there was also the S that we use now. This was both in printed text as well as in written text. And eventually the long S was phased out. And this group is basically saying that it's worth bringing back and that it has its own meaning, its own value. Then the third group is probably a little bit more modern. But if you think of the emojis, the emoji keyboard that we have on our many of our devices, there's actually a group that writes the Unicode, sort of the text that sits behind that. And it's their job. They have board meetings and people come and petition them and pitch to them and say, most recently I read about a drone company wants the inclusion of a drone on the emoji keyboard. So they go with their little petition and they have their little whiteboard and their presentation, their slides, maybe some cards made up, and they say, we need an emoji for drones. And then there might be, if you remember, perhaps the time when emojis got different skin tones, that would be another example where the Unicode group was consulted. I think they call themselves the Unicode Consortium. And people go to them and petition and say, we want this emoji, or oftentimes even something like, we want this emoji taken away or made to look different. I think something like the peach emoji was changed at one point so that it kind of lost some of the associations that it had. So these are three groups that we think of as prescriptivist, and they're basically, what that means is that they're dictating something that should happen in the language. If we think of descriptivism, it's a lot harder to find examples because they're less stark, I guess. The obvious example would be a linguist who does descriptive linguistics. So mostly they would be collecting surveys, doing voice recordings of audio, looking for all of the subsystems and noting changes and things that are actually happening. So they might be even, say, on Reddit or Twitter or, you know, a place like that, looking at kind of the language patterns that emerge there. A really easy and memorable example would be something like the Oxford Dictionary, which each year comes out and sort of makes the news for including a new word that they've decided is worth dictionarying, worth codifying. And that's basically like, you know, something like a belfie, a butt selfie, and sort of new words like that. Neo pronouns to describe kind of the non he, she, I, you, we pronouns and the new ones that have been added. So this is a form of descriptivism, but it's also the difference between standardization and codification. So standardization is basically what the Oxford Dictionary is looking for. They're looking for basically, okay, how long has this word been in use? Has it become standardized in the sense that has it been used by enough people? Has it been, you could look at Google Trends, for example, for uses of words, and you can see it sort of graphed going up or going down. The Oxford Dictionary is basically saying at a certain point that word has been standardized, it's become standard in its use, and then to turn it into a dictionary entry is to codify it. So you can see the Oxford Dictionary is both doing descriptivism in the sense that they're kind of describing what's out there, and then at some point they're doing prescriptivism in the sense that they put it in a dictionary, which then prescribes that it's an official word, goes in the Scrabble dictionary, all those sort of things, it becomes codified, legitimate, real, and important. So descriptivism, prescriptivism, and some little examples to help, hopefully help it stick in your mind, the difference between the two.